Good morning, everyone. It's early in the morning today.
Good morning, Rabbi. Before we start, if I could ask you a question. I have a relative who's been ill for quite a period of time, and unfortunately, you know, the doctors have said now that he's only got a few more days to live. And I've been saying, you know, Misha Berach for him, and you know, prayers for the sick while he's been ill. But now that essentially, you know, they say he has no chance at this point, it's just a matter of time. Do we continue to say the prayers for the sick, or do we stop at that point?
First, as we always make those prayers for speedy recovery. It's part of our belief that the rabbis tells us that afilu cherub chada monachat al tzavaro shel adam al yitayesh min harachamim, which means even the sharp sword is at the front of the throat of the person, he still need to daven. We strongly believe in the power of our prayer. Part of the traditional Judaism is the idea that we believe in the power of our prayers. So there is a discussion in Gemara. There's some situations that they stated about the student of Rebbe, that he was very ill, and the student was davening him, and the maid, she was furious that they are davening while they're basically praying to expedite, in a way to prolong his suffering.
Mm-hmm.
So she went to the second floor, the Gemara said, and she pulled down something very heavy, and it created a huge noise, and he passed. So it's a big discussion, because even ghosts, most ghosts in Lamita, that most of the people who are close to the end, eventually they will die, but we're not allowed to take any active euthanasia in
right.
any way. So because we're not allowed to active euthanasia, now you ask a question. So there's a story about Rabbi Yochanan, there's a few stories in Gemara about davening. So they said basically, there is a time, like King Solomon said, et lamut, there is a time to live, mm-hmm. time to die.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, since we believe in the power of prayer, there is a time for us not to pray. But you can ask even deeper question, do we allow to pray that the person will die? It's a very famous rabbinic writing about women that came before Rabbi Yossi ben Gamliel, and she said that she is past the age of old age, let's trace that she's 105,
mm-hmm.
and she said that she have no meaning of life and she wants to die. And she went and she said to Rabbi, what should I do to die? I'm not allowed to commit suicide and things like that. And he said to her, what do you do? And she said, I'm at the shul every day, in the women's section. So he said to her, don't come to shul 3 days. So the rabbi said that she didn't come to shul 3 days, and the third day she passed. So as a result of that, it's asking question, is that some type of passive euthanasia in any form?
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't believe in the power of prayer, so why bother? But if you do believe in the power of prayer, so you're basically indirectly asking for passive euthanasia, because
mm-hmm.
if you stop praying,
right.
or if you're praying to stop, you know, to expedite his demise, so you're indirectly creating a passive euthanasia.
Mm-hmm.
In short, basically, the key point is we praying because it's out of our hands, it's in Hashem's
mm-hmm.
hands. So therefore, we praying. There are some poskim that hold that there is a certain time you stop praying.
Mm-hmm.
But for sure, it's not in our spirit to pray for expedition of demise of anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Since we don't know the exact cheshbon. We said there's a poskim that said, Hashem make the person straight and mevakesh cheshbonot, that they try to make an account to understand why things happen in certain ways. So therefore, it's not in our account. We need in our tamim tiyeh, we need to do what we have to do, which is praying. And there is a certain time that some hold that certain time you can stop praying, but nothing more than that in that sense. in general, the general term, I know in all my rabbeim, we pray up to the very last moment, even it was a time that it's a very little hope. So as we said, we wish always that things turn around and it should be a refuah shleima.
Thank you.
While you mentioned that, we didn't start with the shiur, but basically the whole idea of Parsha Chukat and Parah Aduma, the whole idea of the red cow, so the Midrash said that Parah Aduma is a nation of Israel, which Mark Twain said, and many other philosophers said that one of the things we don't understand, it's the secret for the Jewish survival. So it's one of these things that no one understands. All these other nations rise up and disappear, and only the Jewish nation survive despite all the predictions of God forbid, disappearance. So that's the Parah Aduma. There's certain things we don't understand. Certain things it's above us. Zayin Amud Bet Megillah. Masechet Megillah, we continue in the Mishnah. En ben yom tov le Shabbat, ela ochel nefesh bilvad. Beautiful Mishnah. So, first is Akdamas, few other introduction. Since the previous Mishnayot, dealing with the words, ein bein is just, it makes some differentiation between certain things. We talked in the previous time about Ein Bein, the 14 and 15 of Adar. So since we use that terminology, we, in a way, even digressing to different subjects, while the title is the same, Ein Bein. So now we're going to a little different sugiot, but the key words, it's Ein Bein. It's in a way, it's about the same in certain ways. Here the Mishnah speaks about the definition, the Musag, Isur Melacha, the prohibition of doing work. So, again, this Mishnah Yad, not dealing with Purim and not dealing with Kriyat HaMegillah. Just because we talk about the differentiate between the first of Adar, the second of Adar, etc., you know, all the difference in the fulfilling certain mitzvot, so now we're dealing with the Ein Bein.
Okay, so the question I'd ask was, since, you know, we talk about the differences between Shabbat and Yom Tov, and they say, you know, food preparation is, you know, allowed on Yom Tov and not on Shabbat. So, and they're saying that's the difference. But one of the other differences that we often experience is that we get to, that we carry on Yom Tov when we're not allowed to carry on Shabbat outside of an Eruv. Mm-hmm. So, does that mean the ability to carry, does that have to have something to do with food preparation? Or is that allowed under some other...
The ability to carry
on Yom Tov.
One is nothing to do with the other.
So, because, you know, if I read this Mishnah, it sounds that the only difference is food preparation.
Let's go slowly.
Okay.
Yom Tov definition.
Mm-hmm.
We have the Chagim,
mm-hmm.
festivals. Pesach.
Mm-hmm.
Pesach, it's basically, in a way, three parts. In Eretz Israel, is 1 and 7, the first day and the seventh day.
Mm-hmm.
Diaspora, so far until Mashiach, first and second,
right.
7, 8. Those days, for our understanding, is let's use the Israeli way, which is the first and the seventh.
Mm-hmm.
We are prohibited from doing melacha, from doing time before.
Right.
In between. Chol HaMoed,
mm-hmm.
intermediary day. It's chol, it's similar to a
right.
regular day. There are certain restrictions, but it's a similar to day. Shavuot, the first, here's the 2 days. Sukkot, 1 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
Here it's basically 1 and 2 and 8 and 9.
Mm-hmm.
Same Rosh Hashanah. So, in that sense, Yom Tov appear like Shabbat. It means you don't switch on lights,
mm-hmm.
you don't open your store, etc. It's in a way equivalent
right.
than Shabbat. Now, when you use that, you say that this is klal, this is a general term that is the same as Shabbat. excluding one single item. The Mishnah said, Ela, only type of work that you do for the purpose of Ochel Nefesh, in order to prepare certain food to eat at the same day, at Yom Tov, Bil Vad, only. Meaning, the Torah allows us, for example, on Yom Tov, to do Shechitat Behima, to slaughter an animal on Yom Tov, in order to eat it
on Yom Tov.
On Yom Tov. Shabbat, you can do that. Okay. Shabbat, you cannot bake. So, the remez here, the Mishnah using the word bilvad, bilvad meaning not everything. For example, preparation, hachana lebishul, preparation for cookings, okay? Or to turn on the oven, or to create a fire, you cannot do on Yom Tov. What you can do is ma'avir me'esh le'esh. You're transferring existing presets, fire, to another one, and in that sense, you're not creating a new one, and all of that, it's for the sake of that particular food for that day.
Right.
Which means not everything allow, lo hakol mutar, not everything is allowed, only bilvad certain things. So, for example, the using example, I give you several examples. The Rashi here used the word, if you look at the Rashi, you see, lihiyot mutar lechatchila b'yom tov ma she'asur b'shabbat. You see this Rashi? So what did the Rashi mean? So the whole idea is that the Mishnah speaks about Rashi meant to say only things that you're allowed to do on Yom Tov lechatchila, even it's prohibited on Shabbat. Soon the Gemara speaks in that sense of the onashim, or certain punishment. It's a different definition, different category, but it's not the point of the Mishnah. Some example: shchita, slaughtering, lisha, bishul, like cookings, baking, afia. So the Torah said, kol melacha lo yase bahem, you cannot do any work, ach asher ye'achel lekol nefesh, but something that you need as a food, immediate food for that particular day of Yom Tov, hu levado yase lachem, that's the only one you can do on Yom Tov, which means even for the sake of eating, the Gemara in Beitzah tells us that even something that you need for eating, we not allow everything. For example, you're not allowed to cut the harvest. You're not allowed to go and hunt for an animal on Shabbat. That's not. So it's a basically a dispute what exactly and how you allow, but is in a very general term ochel nefesh. So that's applied to Yom Tov. Iruv, as you ask, it's basically Shabbat. On Yom Tov you can carry, but this is nothing to do with the type of melacha in that sense. The Iruv is a different definition. But let's go back to the machloket.
Was the prohibition to carry on Shabbat, is that a rabbinical prohibition?
No.
That's...
it's the Torah.
Right.
Yes, but in that sense here, the Mishnah speaks about the zoom in. The topic here is in the two sources. There is Gemara in Shabbat, Kuf Kav Dalet, 124, and is also Gemara in Beitzah, that speaking in a famous machloket between Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel. A Beit Hillel hold only type of work that you need to do for the ochel nefesh, for the food that you need for that particular Yom Tov, that's the only one that you're allowed to do on Yom Tov. But if you need to do other things, so Beit Hillel said, we don't wish to, but if you have to do it, do it, right? It's in the definition, I'll say it first in Hebrew and then in English. In Hebrew they said, מתוך שהותרה לצורך אוכל נפש, הותרה גם לצורך אחר. Beit Hillel said, since we allow to do it for אוכל נפש, in certain situation you can even extend it a little bit.
So, if I understand
correctly. So, for example, in that Mishnah they speak about carrying in public domain, as you said, in an Eruv.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like little baby, like lulav, mm-hmm. like Sefer Torah. Beit Shammai prohibited, Beit Hillel allowed.
So Beit Shammai said if it's related to food preparation, then you can carry. Beit Hillel was more, little more flexible.
Beit Shammai said that. That the only exception is only if you need it for letzorech achila. Beit Hillel said, since you allow lo letzorech, which means le'ochel nefesh, you allow also other things. So the Rambam explained in this Mishnah, it's all his explanation, also others, Tosfot, if I'm not mistaken, Beitza. Also deal with that. But anyway, the point is that we, you know, Beit Hillel, so we're extending it, but Beit Shammai makes sense in a sense that they said that the Torah specifically said, Hu Levado. We go by Beit Hillel in a sense of leniency, but Beit Shammai carries some merits in their opinion.
But so is it? It is Lechatchila if you follow Beit Hillel. Or is that Bediavad?
Oh, it's not Lechatchila or Bediavad. Basically, we follow the final halacha, and the final halacha is that Ochel Nefesh, in a certain situation, again, certain condition, which is you transferring existing fire, you do all the hachana, all the preparation in advance, etc. For sure, in some cases, there is the Eruv Tavshilim, etc. Depends how it's attached to Shabbat. Then you can go ahead and prepare it, in a sense, do the final stage for the sake of that particular day, not for the following day, or for not for other purpose, not to freeze food or anything else. Okay, now we go a little bit to the Gemara. So the Gemara said that the only thing that we are lenient on Yom Tov more than the Shabbat, it's only for Ochel Nefesh. Now, just we have to go by the psukim. We soon go and zoom in the way that the Torah bring a certain psukim, a certain sentences, when we derive from those sentences our conclusions. So, in general, the Torah have a very strong language when it comes to Shabbat. God created the world, he on Shabbat rested in our language, and then it's a ongoing, a lot of strong positive and negative commandment in relate to Shabbat. Yom Tov, it's lo ta'aseh. It's a basically a, in a sense, a negative expression, but it's written in a much linear way, the way that we take the psukim. How? So let's read. Ha, but le'inyan machshirei ochel nefesh, which means Hachshara, in that sense, is a certain melachot, certain type of work that you need to do in order to prepare food for Shabbat. So it means, for Yom Tov, which means that that food you don't need for the SSA, Ochel Nefesh itself, but as preparation. An example, you need to take a knife, okay, and that knife you need, for example, for cutting food, for doing, as we said, slaughtering, etc. There is a certain stage of preparations. Those who study Hilchot Shechita, they see that the Ashchazat HaSakinim, preparation of the knives, is a very important stage before you machshir, you allow to use that knife for Shechita. So, if you need to do that preparation, as much as we like to allow you to do Ochel Nefesh on Yom Tov, but that not include which we call machshirei. Machshirei meaning preparations stage in order to have ochel nefesh. If you need to prepare the, let's say you have something that move around the kebab, the steaks, right? So that stage of preparations for that you cannot do on Yontov, because slaughtering and final cooking, it's ochel nefesh. It's part of the food you need. But preparations, it's only called machshire. It's only preparation. So therefore, we're not allowed to do that. He says, "Aval leinyan machshire ochel nefesh, ze veze shavim," which means when it's come to the preparation of food, right? So we say that is both of them are equal, which means the prohibition of both Shabbat and Yontev is equal. It's the same that we both cannot do machshire ochel nefesh. There's no difference. Now, since we talk about ochel nefesh, matnitin delo kerabi Yuda, since we always do juxtaposition to other sources, so we now go to a brayta, the Tanya. We said in a brayta, en ben yom tov le Shabbat, ela ochel nefesh. Rabbi Yehuda Matir of Machshire Ochel Nefesh. So we said in that brayta the same as the Mishnah, that there is no difference between Yom Tov and Shabbat. Is both something that prohibited on Shabbat, prohibited on Yom Tov, only something you need for the sake of eating immediate food, and not Machshire, not preparation. However, in that brayta, there is an opinion of Rabbi Yehuda who said, no, we can extend that to even the stage of preparation, which is called Machshire Ochel Nefesh, that in that sense he holds that on Yom Tov, not on Shabbat, on Yom Tov, you can do Machshire Ochel Nefesh by Rabbi Yehuda.
Which means preparing, like preparing the knives. And
preparing the knife. Mm-hmm. So now we need to know the source. My Tama, the Tana Kama. What's the reason of the Tana Kama? The Tana Kama, what did he say? The first opinion, he said that only ochel nefesh itself, but not machshire ochel nefesh. Amar Kra, the pasuk said in the book of Shmot, Exodus 12, they said, ach asher ye'achel ochel nefesh, whatever you need as immediate food for the yontem, hu levado, that's only one, ye'aseh lachem, you can do it. So who, by making this, the Torah, we always said, is very prudent in words. So since the Torah used the word who, which means that specific, meaning that only the specific part of the eating food, it's okay. Velo machshirav, but not the preparations. So that's the opinion of Tana Kama, and that's the reason we not allow it.
Is cutting food for preparation, is that considered preparation, or is that okay?
Cutting food for preparation, it's like, a good question.
For example, making a fruit salad or something, is that something you should do in advance, or is that something?
If you do fruit salad for the sake of immediate needs, then sometimes it really depends on certain things, but it's in a very general terms, it's okay as long as it's
for that particular
meal, right, for that particular need right away.
Gotcha.
Rabbi Yehuda that disagree with that, he said, Amar Kra, the pasuk said, Lachem. When the Torah use the word Lachem, what does that mean, Lachem? Lachem lechol tzorcheichem. When the Torah used the word lachem, meaning the food that you need for food, you know, to eat, so he explained that it's not the everything. It's lechol tzorchechem. What you need is tzorchechem, the food that you need for the sake of the meal. Ve'idach nami aktiv lachem. So how the other Tana explain the word lachem, what is lachem means. So he said, lachem ולא לעובדי כוכבים, לכם ולא לכלבים. Meaning, by using the word לכם, it means that the אוכל נפש will allow, it's allow only for immediate need of you, but not for the neighbor idolater, or for the animals and other things that may need. It's applied only to, so in other words, Rabbi Yehuda agree with that, but he hold that the word lachem has two meanings. One, lechol tzochechem, which means machshire ochel nefesh. Two, you, but not to idolaters or dogs in that sense. That's the ritva point of view. Now, soon we put the whole conclusion of all of that. Ve'idach name haktiv hu. So now we explain this part. So now why we need the word hu, which means, according to Rabbi Yehuda, how we explain the additional, looks like additional word hu, how he explained that if he said that we allow machshire ochel nefesh, and not only ochel nefesh itself, so how he explained the additional word of who, that specific, he said, k'tiv, who k'tiv lachem, so he said that what the Torah meant is not a kan, במכשירים שאפשר לעשותם מערב יום טוב, כאן מכשירים שאי אפשר לעשותם מערב יום טוב. So it means that he tried to say that sometimes when it's come to מכשירי, there is a certain situation that you can prepare it in advance before the holidays, and sometimes you can do it before the holidays. So Rabbi Yehuda permits only something that you cannot that you did not do before Yom Tov, but otherwise he said that you cannot do it. So let me elaborate.
Is there a problem with preparing food for, if you're preparing a meal and there's going to be several Jews coming over, but there's also going to be a non-Jew with them, is that a problem since you part of the preparation was for a non-Jew?
So here you're dealing with different question, which is the whole concept of having other guests
because I'm just reading here, it says for you and not for idolaters. So, okay, I mean, I assume that's for Jews,
that
but not for
idolaters. It's not the idolaters, power Jews.
Right.
It's not the non-Jews. The idolater in that sense, it means when the Torah allow it, it's in a way that there is a lechatchila, the way that they're expecting you to do, and there is bediavad, which means, and that's basically the point I want to a little bit elaborate in order to get the clear point. Rashi and Tosfot explains here that the way that the psukim is written in Shabbat is the punishment is skila, stone. When it's come to Yom Tov, since it's lo taseh, is the malkot, is the lashes, which is a very different. So even machshire ochel, it's prohibited, but Rabbi Yehuda said that you can go ahead and preparing a knife for the sake of Yom Tov, because he learned from the word hu. Mm-hmm. It's mi'ut. So, here's the point. If you need to do something, it's not that there are certain food, take for example, challah, mm-hmm. or take schnitzel, okay? So, he said, you cannot compare challah that you're baking before Yom Tov, or challah that you're baking on Yom Tov. Which means the freshness, the taste. Right. The schnitzel, it's not the same. So he said, I'm just giving you the abbreviation. The Gemara said in Shabbat, Tzadikei, it's 95, the Gemara said that in Shabbat, violation of Shabbat, you had the Korban Chatat, the sin offering. In Yom Tov, it's 40 lashes, you know, the Malkot. Now, even in Ochel Nefesh, not everything allow, which means if you need before the meal, the challah or the schnitzel, okay? That's in a general term allow. But because you basically improving the situation, okay? But in general, if it's lo meshabchan velo mekalkelan, you don't change the status by that. But take for example cheese, gvina. It's a concept that's called megaben, which means the cheese that is cheese that of today and cheese that was left over from yesterday, it's a different quality. In cheese, what happens is that if you do it before Yontiv, so then what happens is it's better, right? So that's prohibited. So the whole concept is this. We basically would like you to have everything in advance.
Okay.
If there is a situation you need to do something, we said the exception the Torah allow you is if you need it for the sake of eating the meal.
Mm-hmm.
But we want you to be in a way circumscribed, to be limited in the extension. We don't want that to be without boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
So in that concept, the concept of idolaters or klavim or dog, it's applied that we want you to focus on ochel nefesh, of foods that you need for the sake of the seuda in immediate manner.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So again.
So I guess that's saying if you happen to have a guest and you're preparing food for Jews as well, and one of the guests is a non-Jew, that's not.
We'll say this. We're living in a diaspora,
mm-hmm.
and there are endless circumstances that people come.
Well, you know, someone who's married to a non-Jew who happens to be Jewish, they might be invited.
All kind of situations.
Right?
Yeah. So as we said. The foundation of this discussion is food
mm-hmm.
you need
mm-hmm.
for the sake of the meal.
Right.
Right?
So all the Jews aren't going to starve because you have one non-Jew there that you're not going to prepare the food for. So.
Next Mishnah, again, is dealing with Ein Bein, and it's dealing with Melachot. The Mishnah said as follows, Ein Bein Shabbat Liyom HaKippurim. In regards to the chumrah, to the strong prohibition against doing work, ela shezez dono bidei adam, vezez dono bekaret, which means doing type of work, Shabbat, intentionally, this is the punishment by the bet din, which means if it was witnesses and they warned the person, so that means that the bet din inflicted punishment upon that person. Veze zdono bekaret. If someone did intentionally melacha on yantiv, so the punishment is called karet, which means that is bidei shamayim, is by heaven, that the Torah said that soul shall be cut off. It means that it's not a bet din, there's something, it's in a sense from heaven.
Isn't those desecration of the Shabbat also a punishable by heaven? Aren't you also punishable by being cut off?
Excellent. If there is a dim in hatra'ah, if it was a warning, and it was a witnesses that mm-hmm. that saw it, then it's bidei adam. There are certain situations that you don't have those conditions.
Right.
And then we call it mita bidei shamayim. So now the Gemara said, Hale inyan tashlumim. Since the Mishnah said that Yom Kippur is different from Shabbat, that in a sense of punishment, that only in the desecration of Shabbat by a person, by Beit Din punished, but not Yom Kippur, Hale inyan tashlumim. Okay? If a person did one thing, right? For example, I give you the concept, it's called Kimle Bederaba Minei. This is a concept that in Bava Kama, but I just give you the abbreviation of what is that mean. So the Sugya in Bava Kama speaks about Kimle Bederaba Minei, which means we are satisfied with the big punishment that included the small one. For example, if you have your friends, let's say your friend have a field, and you went ahead and burned his field.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now you did that, if you did it during the week, so let's say the damage is $1 million, okay, but he owed the bank $800,000, okay? So what's happened is, so basically you need to bring the million, but the millions that you pay, the millions, the 800,000 is included. What does that mean? So so if you have two punishments and one of them, the payment is higher than the others, we basically included one with the other. Right. Which means, I just give you the abbreviation because we're running out of time. It means that when someone gets punishment, such as a that soul should be cut off, or that as such as a very severe punishment, you included in that punishment other things. So for example, if someone burned his fellow field, so and he did it on Shabbat, so he did the melacha, it's called melechet havara, he did it on Shabbat, and also he need to pay for burning his fellow field. So we said ze veze shavim, which means there's no difference between Shabbat and Yom Kippur, that you don't ask the person to pay. Why? Because he is already gets death penalty, death punishment. So since he gets death penalty, you don't inflict it on him, the payment. So soon you see a discussion over that, because if you tell me that, the big question the rabbi is going to ask is, how you can help the situation? Since he burned his fellow field and he caused the damage, how are you helping the other fellow by doing what? By killing him?
Right, where the argument, if he had done it on the day that wasn't Shabbat, he would have paid him $1 million, but it's just because it wasn't Shabbat, he doesn't pay him the money.
That's part of the discussion. That's called Himle B'Derav HaMinek. Thank you very much.